Hi, you're listening to the Child Wellbeing Podcast, and this episode is called the German Socioeconomic Panel. I am Tanya, and today we're going to talk to Dr. David Richter. Dr. Richter is a special guest from the German Institute for Economic Research, DIW, in Berlin. David, welcome to the Child Wellbeing Podcast.
Thank you for the introduction.
Could you tell us about the German Socioeconomic Panel study?
So, what is the ZEP? The German Socioeconomic Panel study. It was started in 1984. We now have 33 waves available, 34 waves. And it's the longest running multiple cohort longitudinal study of private households and persons in the Federal Republic of Germany. It started with 6,000 households in 1984. And now we have about 12,500 households with about 30,000 individuals. Since the beginning, there was an oversampling of foreigners and migrants, and then right in 1999, East Germans, and there was a top-up sample of high-income respondents, and then we had some more top-up samples representative for the whole population, and in the last 2 years, there was a dedicated refugee sample, sampling the refugee population that came to Germany since 2015. It's representative for private households in Germany. It's a theory-based, multidisciplinary mix of subjective and objective data on households, individuals, and families. And we have microdata for research in social and behavioral sciences as well as economics. So 50% of the users are from the field of economics. And it's possible to do a regional comparison. And we also have local context indicators available. So you can match a lot of local indicators for the regions the people are living in. And you can also get the GPS coordinates to match whatever you have on GPS basis, like the number of trees in the surroundings or the amount of light during the night or whatever you like.
And what opportunities does it offer to further household panel studies?
So there are increasing opportunities for long-running household panel studies, at least we think that way, because the observation unit household guarantees appropriate coverage of births and deaths, and we have a large sample size. We have many rare events by pooling of the data sets, so even events that don't happen that often, like divorce or mortality, we have information on these events, and it's possible to integrate, to have intergenerational analysis by linking parents and children.
What are the advantages of panel data?
We sample information from different phases of the life, so it's possible to identify transition phases and important life events, and hopefully their causal effects. We can control, or it's possible with the data to control for time constant exogenous variables, and therefore to approach causality. It's possible to conduct trend analysis, and even to the decomposition of trends is possible with the data.
What is the life course perspective about in the German socioeconomic panel study?
So we already collecting data before the persons are born because we have their parents in the sample. So we call this the conception or planning stage. So even before the person is born, we already have some information on them because we have information on the physical and mental condition of the mother and the partner, if the partner's in the household, their education level, if they are smoking or not, and other variables you can think of. Then the person is born. Then we have information on their preschool period, on the primary school period, secondary school. Then nowadays we even start to sample, or we ask the 12-year-olds, they get their own questionnaire, and they report their life satisfaction and so on for themselves. I will tell you more about this later on. Then there's adult life with all the indicators for objective and subjective living conditions and so on. We collect on a daily level, and then after the death of the person, we even collect memories of the widower or the widow, and information on pension and so on. So you come into the panel before you're born, and you never leave it.
And what time dimensions does the German socioeconomic panel study consider?
We collect information from different time dimensions regarding the present. We asked how respondents' situations in the present, like their current employment status or their current life satisfaction. Then we asked some information about the past, retrospective questions about events, history of events since the age of 15, like employment calendar for all the years they did before they entered the panel, monthly calendar of income and employment, and then also some information about the future. So expectations about the future, satisfaction in 5 years, satisfaction or expectations regarding employment. So different time perspectives as well. And then there are different topics. So this is the second part of the talk where I shortly introduce all the different topics or most of the different topics we have in the sub.
Can you tell us about the topics that are included in the study?
Well-being started already in 1984, so we have the question on life satisfaction since 1984. Affective well-being or the emotions were introduced in 2007. And sorrows, like the negative part of well-being, also surveyed since 1984, including an open text question where we asked the respondents what else they are worried about. And this is what you can do with this data, because we also know how the persons are feeling before the event is on the horizon. So even 5 years before the event, we already know, we already have some information on life satisfaction. You can plot those curves and see how people respond to various events. And you can see that, for instance, for divorce, it's already getting better if the event is happening. So the worst part for divorce, for instance, you can see that it's too late if you sample respondents that experience a divorce, because they are already feeling better. So the worst thing is 1 year before the divorce is happening.
So besides from well-being, what other topics or variables are covered by the study?
And there are some more events where you can see a comparable picture, like for marriage, for instance, it goes already up before you marry, and then afterwards it's going right down. Then you can also see that income decline and income jump doesn't do much, but this is also on a very high level probably, because most people in Germany are doing quite well. You can also see that some adaptation is taking place for disability. Yeah, and then you can also see that there are events of the partner that also influence the respondent themselves. So if the partner is dying, of course, it's a very severe event, but also unemployment of the partner has an influence on the respondents. And this can also, this can only be seen if you have the whole household context sampled, of course. So if you have every respondent in the household. Then we have some more variables on personality. We have the Big Five inventory, risk aversion, locus of control, reciprocity, impulsiveness and patience, trust and fairness, personal networks, self-esteem, loneliness, life goals, and so on. And for most of these, we have longitudinal information, because we sampled or we asked those about those constructs for many years now. It all started with locus of control. This was the first one introduced. And then all the other came during the recent years.
Does the study include behavioral issues?
We have some behavioral experiments. We collect cognitive competencies with two small tests. And then there are some experiments on trust and reciprocity done in 2003, 4, and 5. One experiment on risk aversion.
Have you also gathered data on childhood issues?
We also have this now for kindergarten quality. So we know, we asked them which preschool their children are visiting, and then there was a survey of the preschools. So we have some indications for the preschool quality for some of the children in the survey. Yeah. Okay, and here, so this were employer reports, and then this is what we have on childhood development. So in 2003, we introduced the BioH1 questionnaire for children aged 0 to 1 years. And so the mother's report gives some information on pregnancy and birth, health of the child, and so on. And we already, at the moment, we have 5,300 questionnaires, or we have information on 5,300 children here. in 2005, the questionnaire for the 2 to 3 year olds was introduced and so on. And in 2014, for the first time, the children themselves were interviewed. So we have the questionnaire for the 12 year olds, and here the children themselves report their activities, their care and child situation, homework, personality, social emotional behavior, educational aspirations and expectations, and also well-being. And from most of those questions are already, we already have information from the parents from the years before this. And so for some of them, we even have information, for instance, on their temperament right after they were born, and then their self-reported life satisfaction at the age of 12. And this was then again done at the age of 14. So we also have longitudinal information for those young children since the age, self-reported at the age of 12 and the age of 14. And this is something almost nobody knows about. So if you want to do something with this data, the chances are pretty high that nobody else looked into this. Seeing that we have already 10,000 papers with this, but not on these topics or with those children, with those data.
Can you tell us about an intervention study that you conducted some time ago?
This was done 2 years ago, where some of the respondents were selected to meet Chancellor Merkel, and then we afterwards looked if this boosts their interest in politics, and this was the case. So those 100 respondents that got to meet Merkel, they were more interested in politics afterwards.
Have there been changes in the survey mode? Has that affected the data?
Okay, this is how we collect the survey. We have standard instruments that are surveyed annually. So we have a household questionnaire for the head of the household, where we collect all the temporarily changing household information. And then we have the individual questionnaire, where we collect the information for the individuals. And then there's a biographical instrument that is only used once when the person enters the panel. So here, the supplementary biography questions are asked, like if they have any children, when they were born, how they grow up, nationality of the parents, and so on. And this is how you get into the panel. So you can either be, or most of them were drawn and selected into the sample. Some of them were born into a sub-household. Some moved into a sub-household. So if a new partner moves in, then he's also in the panel. And this happened rarely seldom. So no, this is quite often happening. So if you establish a household of an established sub-household member, you're also in the panel. And this is how you exit from the sub: by death, by moving abroad, or by refusal. So if you refuse for 2 times, you are out. And if you refuse only 1 time, the interviewer will return in the next year and try to get you again.
And what are the challenges for panel studies?
And so panel studies, they have to face some challenges. We have distribution due to distortion due to panel attrition. So if some respondents drop out, and if dropout is not at random, the panel gets distorted. We try to mitigate this by coming up with weights, so you can weight the data. Economists, they usually don't use the weights. Psychologists also don't use them, but the sociologists, they use the weights, and they are pretty, they are convinced that it's the right way to do. But yeah, so depends on your discipline, I guess. Then we have some panel effects. You can try to control, or you can try to see them if you compare respondents that are sampled for the first time with respondents that are longer in the panel. And what you usually see is that the responses are getting a little bit more extreme because the respondents realize that nobody judges them and that they can report what they really think about things.
How do you deal with constant changes in the population?
So then it's limited generalizability due to constant changes in the population. We try to deal with this by collecting refreshment samples, like migration samples, aiming at respondents that moved to Germany in recent years, or like this refugee sample, where we target refugees to get them, because of course they are not in the panel. before we try to get them there. And then we also have to deal with the repetition of identical question and also the need to adapt to change and new topics. And we try to do this by rotating modules, so not every question is asked every year. We try to rotate the questions a little bit. And things that don't change that often, like personality, is asked only every 5 years, and all the some stuff is asked every year, so we try to change this a little bit. And this is how the sample is drawn. So at the beginning, there's the population of households in Germany, so it's not persons in Germany, it's German households, or households in Germany, not German households, but households in Germany. And there's some, this is where the sampling starts. There are sampling points, those are randomly, those are distributed across Germany. There's some firms that are providing those sampling points. So we, Infratest, not we, but our fieldwork institute Infratest, they take those sampling points, and then a random sample of sampling points is drawn, and from those sampling points, what randomly addresses are drawn out of those sampling points, and at those addresses, a random route is started to select the actual address that is asked to take part in the household.
Can you tell us about participation in your study?
In 1984, all was good. More than 60% of the households chose to take part. It was even better in Eastern Germany in 1990. Almost 70% of the households took part in the survey. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, it's only got worse. So it's going down. And now we have about 30%, 33 or 35% of the Brutto sample that it's willing to take part in a survey. So this got, went down over time. For the refugees, it was quite high. So for the refugees, again, it's more than 60%. And also for this families in Germany sample, it was also quite good. We had about 46%, I guess, because the interviewers went to the household and they said, this is a survey about the life of families in Germany. And then they went to families with many kids or with single parent families. And so this was something interesting for them. And so the initial response was higher. Yeah.
And how do you explain this? Do you know why is this happening?
Yeah, there are different explanations for this. Some think that it's because people, they don't feel that responsible anymore for society. Because if you come to a household and say, this is a household panel, we want to learn what's going on in Germany, and in the 80s people felt responsible to give information about things going on, and nowadays nobody cares anymore. This is one explanation. The other explanation could be that there's too much household research is going on, so there are telephone surveys from different survey institutes, there are household surveys and so on, so nobody is interested to take part in the real surveys anymore. One other way would be that it's, yeah, that also the incentives had worsened it. So at the beginning, the SERP only gave one a lottery ticket as an incentive, and nowadays we pay money because everybody pays money, and some surveys, they pay a lot of money, like PIAC, they pay 50 euros for participation, and this also makes it worse for everyone. At least this is one explanation, that if some pay more, then everybody expects more, or you lose some respondents who think, okay, if I get paid 50 euros, I don't want to do this anymore because I thought this is part of my responsibility as a citizen, and now I get so much money, I don't want to do this. So, yeah. And nobody really knows, I guess, the truth here. So, yeah.
Has the survey mode changed over time?
So we have some development in the survey mode. At the beginning of the survey, everything was paper and pencil. So the interviewer went to the household and collected the interview with a paper and pencil questionnaire. Some filled in their questionnaire with the interviewer present. So these are mostly, this happened because the interviewer gave one questionnaire to the wife, for instance, and then he did the interview with the husband. And so they save time because they were filling in the questionnaires in parallel. Nowadays, we have the computer-assisted personal interview, and most of the interviews are done in the CAPI mode nowadays. And there are some questionnaires sent out per mail, but not much. So there's also a change in survey mode over time. That, of course, could also influence the data a little bit.
And can you tell us how to get access to this data?
So now some information how you can get the data distribution. The data is protected by data protection laws, so you need to have a user contract with the DIW. And for the access to sensitive information, like the regional data, you have to come to the DIW and do it on site. We have a homepage, of course, where you can find some online support, documentation, FAQ, a newsletter, and also a link to the Research Data Center, where you find information on the data. And then there's something called subinfo, where you find information on variables, questionnaires, constructs, and frequencies.
Can you tell us about the innovation sample?
This was introduced in 2011, and this was started in 2011, has also face-to-face mode with computer-assisted personal interviews. And so this mode allows us to have complex innovative procedures, like complex questions, the reconstruction method, experiments with cash payments, saliva sampling, and so on. And this sample has now 5,500 respondents in 3,500 households. And we also allow cross-references to the ZERP because we have the same topics like the main survey in every year. And here we have some examples of research that was already done with the ZERP innovation sample. So we have we did a combination of DRM and ESM, so we had the reconstruction method in 2012, 13, 14, and 15, and experience sampling in 2014. And this was this is a project by Rich Lucas, financed by the American taxpayers. And here the plan is to get some deeper insights on life satisfaction, because we have the generalized measurement, the episodic data from the daily construction method, and then real-time data from the experience sampling. And hopefully, if you combine them, you get some more insights how respondents respond to different life events, because we also have longitudinal data. And yeah.
Can information on social media be gathered and used?
Yeah, this is actually something I want to do in the next years, and this is what we plan to do in the next years. But I think we should try it, and I think it will be quite okay, because they trust us, and if they are independent for some time, and we tell them, okay, we want to measure your daily steps, or just the usage of the phone, how often per day you look onto it, or you unlock it, yeah. And or the when you turn it off and turn it on again, or whatever. And at the moment, it's looking quite good, I guess, because also our person at the BMBF, she said we should be much more innovative with the innovation sample.
So thank you, David, for sharing with us all of this very interesting information about the German socioeconomic panel. See you next time.